Good morning. This is Sally Morgan, physical therapist, craniosacral therapist, and Tellington T Touch practitioner for animals and people. This is Tristan. He's a corgi, and we're here for an episode of Conversations with a Corgi. And we have no music today because the phone that has the music on it has gotten terminally ill. It doesn't work if it's not literally plugged in, and there's no plug near here. Well, there might be, but it's pretty far away. Anyway. Oh, there's one right there. Maybe it'll be living in this room from now on. Anyway, we're here for an episode of Conversations with a Corgi. And I know that there's a lot going on in the world right now with the tornadoes and the virus and, you know, the politics. There's just a lot. But there's a few things that I think we need to address related to all that. And one is the treatment of animals. This virus and many other viruses that have circulated around the United States in the last 20 years come from animals and come from China. Now, every culture is different. Every culture does what they think is the right thing. However, the treatment of animals is a critical concern for me and probably everybody that will listen to this. And the treatment of animals for meat and food in particular is wretched because, you know, a lot of people just figure if the animal's going to be eaten, why should we be nice to him? And in my area, there are so many people that raise their own beef and they don't make them pets, but they want to make sure they're eating good food and being treated humanely and have a good life before they're in their refrigerator. So, and that's a trend in the United States, but we have to give a lot of credit to Temple Grandin, who, you know, is pioneering in so many ways, first of all, as an example for people with disabilities and autism in particular, and for working as a woman in a field dominated by men. And I've worked in the agricultural industry when I first got out of college in 1980, and I can tell you it is a very, very tough thing to do for a woman. I mean, it was extremely emotionally difficult for me to be treated so badly and so disrespectfully by the people that were my colleagues. And people I was interviewing for stories, and to be constantly underestimated, it does wear you out. And Temple put up with all that so because she was committed to developing humane slaughter practices. And, you know, she's written wonderful books about animals. She debunks a lot of research, quote, research, that has proven that animals aren't as smart or don't have emotions or whatever. She looks, because of the way her mind works, she can look objectively at these experiments and see flaws in them left and right. I mean, you know, I do that too, but I don't have the speaking power she has to debunk these things. And, you know, she really is a pioneer in the field of animal research, animal understanding, and certainly humane slaughter of animals. But, you know, we have the swine flu, which came from China from problems with slaughtering swine there. The bird flu, inhumane treatment of chickens and other fowl. And now we have the coronavirus, which we don't know, could be from bats, snakes, or these other guys that look sort of like anteaters that are pretty endangered. And I'm sure all of us have seen on Facebook, you know, pictures of animals, dogs being used for food in China and, you know, just thrown in a big net like fish. I mean, not that we should treat fish that way either, but it's plain out, flat out, inhumane and unsanitary. So one of the things I think that we can do is really advocate for humane treatment of animals, especially the animals that we're going to eat. And how can you do that? One thing I did before I became a vegetarian is only eat kosher meat, because at least when those animals are slaughtered, they are blessed, and that makes a difference. And I can feel myself when I do heart hugs and say prayers for roadkill, that by the fourth time I've done that, some of the charge has been taken out of that circumstance. And, you know, there's a book called The Lost Power of Prayer. Great book, get it. And that talks about how just that positive intention and the prayer makes such a difference. And it certainly impacts the quality of the meat that we're eating. And that intention of, you know, those animals being prayed for in the kosher food industry makes a big difference in, you know, the energetic component of that meat that you're eating. So that's one of the things you can do. You know, buy organic, buy local. Again, most local beef is not slaughtered in inhumane ways and don't have horrible lives trapped in a tiny pen. So advocate in your own life for the humane treatment of animals and tell people about this. People don't know. I found out the other day, one of my friend's first jobs was in a meatpacking plant. And he's an animal lover, corgi lover, great guy. And I was like, how did you do it? And he said, oh, I couldn't eat for a couple of years. I mean, yes, we need people to work in these industries, but it doesn't have to be so horrible as it is. I mean, my sister has talked about this endlessly in terms of what we feed our pets, and trying to get clean, wholesome food for our animals is very difficult, and also for us. So I, as much as people get frustrated with some of the animal activist groups, I am a huge supporter of nearly all of them because they are raising awareness, and that's the first step in making a change. And we certainly, you know, can't fly in the face of ancient cultures and say you can't do that. But look at, for instance, the Native American cultures. They have much more respect for the things that they eat and how they slaughter them and take care of them and, you know, honor them when they are eating them. I mean, there are examples in India. There's a, you know, quite a reverence for cattle there. It's very different than here. Cattle are treated very differently there. Some of them are not in great condition because nobody's taking care of them per se, but, and the poverty can be horrible, but we need to do whatever we can to advocate for humane treatment of animals, especially animals that are in the food chain. And that is for our pets and for us. And raising awareness is a big step. And some of these people listening, some of you guys live in like the Midwest and stuff, and that's where the animal, you know, food industry is located. And, you know, we can do what we can do. Just talking to people about looking into Temple Grandin's ways of slaughtering animals. She found that the cattle stayed calmer if they were walking in circles. And so, you know, she advocated for building facilities where the cattle can walk in circles and not be surprised and horrified. And your production goes better. The animals are less traumatized. Therefore, the meat is better. People like me can taste the difference in humanely slaughtered versus other meat. And so can other people. It makes me sick how dogs, all animals are treated by some. Yeah, it's true. I mean, it's really terrible, and it's cultural, but some of it is because of how the people are treated in these cultures. They don't have good treatment themselves, and so they can't really show that kindness to animals around them either. I think it was Gandhi who said this. Somebody said that you can judge, I think it's Gandhi, that the success of a culture by the way they treat their animals. Because if you're kind to your animals, that means you're kind to the people in the culture. And that means the culture will flourish because you will incubate people's creativity and intuition and insight. And, you know, everything will prosper as a result of kindness in the world. So let's try to send out kindness to the animals in the world and the way people treat them, especially animals in the food chain. It is very, very difficult to make changes in people's cultural beliefs and ways of doing things. And that includes our own culture. You know, we don't have to slaughter animals the way that we do. We don't have to raise them the way that we do. And certainly many family farms have gone under. Even the dairy farms in Vermont are struggling. And, you know, I am a vegetarian, but I do eat cheese and milk and eggs. And I go to a lot of trouble to get organic, grass-fed, farm-raised, free-range of everything so that those animals have good lives. I mean, my mom and my sister bought their own chickens to get eggs that they know are coming from happy, healthy birds that they know what they've been eating. So it can make a big difference. Oh, Danny worked at a pork plant. Ugh. She hated it. Yeah, it's really bad. And of course, it's come a long way since Upton Sinclair wrote his book about the packing houses and the slaughterhouses in California and places around there. But, you know, it still is not what it should be. Just because it's better doesn't mean it's good enough. So we still need to advocate. And Danny, I'm sure you are one of the people that can talk to people about how the animals are treated and try to make changes. You know, eat organic, eat local. That's really what we can do. Use our dollars to support the things that are doing the right things. And we would not be in this panic. I mean, I have several friends that are off the charts panicking and saying things that are just like absolutely not true about the coronavirus and how it got here. But, you know, all these things that we've had in the last few years can be traced back to animal pathogens transferring to humans, and that is a bad thing. And just on a side note related, if you do get sick with even the flu, don't let your dog lick your face, eat your Kleenex, and try really hard not to pet him very much. And if you do, sanitize your hands before you do pet him, because things can be spread to your dog and by your dog to your other house members. So let's try to be nicer to animals, right, Tristan? Especially the animals that give us their lives so that we can live and prosper. And that goes to what we feed our pets as well. So we will try to be back tomorrow. This has gotten very, very difficult for me right now. I'm trying to finish my taxes and I have to keep putting it off because there's things going on that I have to do. And I have clients calling with last minute appointments and whatever. So I will try to be back tomorrow. I do want to talk about some of the oral flea and tick medications and quote medications and why we shouldn't use them at some point soon. And I also want to talk about our personal response to some of these things that are going on in the world that are difficult. So thanks for joining us today. Become an animal activist yourself. Really speak up for animals that are in the food chain and do that with your dollars. If you have to cut out something like maybe that $3 coffee so that you can afford organic milk with animals that are well cared for, and see if you can make a few changes in your life and advocate for that with other people. You don't have to run out and join an animal rights group in order to make a change and benefit the lives of animals around you. So thanks for joining us today. We'll see you soon. Everybody have a great day. Oh, horror stories. Yeah, Danny, I know. Just in an ice cream plant. I was going for a tour when I was in pre-vet school. And even that was more than I could handle. I can't imagine being in a pork processing plant. I know too much about pigs to participate in that. But we do what we have to do. All right, thanks for joining us. Everybody have a great day.